For the past decade or so, I've been studying extraordinary experiences. No one wants an okay experience or a bad experience. People want a great experience. So for example, consistently in Hollywood, 80% of movies lose money. How's that possible when humans have been telling stories to each other for tens of thousands of years? It's because we're really depending on individuals to assess if something's good or bad. Those people are all fallible. They're tired, they're hungry, they have biases. So we've been developing neurologic technology to assess how much the brain values an experience. And that value comes from two core neurologic data streams. One is I've got to pay attention to the experience. If I'm asleep, it's not going to be a great experience. But the second is emotional resonance. It's got to actually make me care about it, like a great movie does, or a great novel does, or a great interaction with a friend. So once I have those two things, this neurologic state I call immersion, then we can assess and measure how effectively creators of experiences are immersing their customers so that they have an amazing experience. And what's interesting is that when the experience is immersive, people remember it, people will act on it, they'll share it with others, and they'll enjoy it. So we began measuring immersion by taking data from the peripheral nervous system. That's a fancy way of saying we steal data from a smartwatch and apply algorithms in the cloud to identify what the brain's doing from the peripheral nerves that innervate the heart. So I've coined the phrase that immersion is the first neuroscience as a service platform that democratizes neuroscience, lets anybody measure what people love at scale in real time. So all those things were hard to figure out, took a lot of years, but it lets us go from movies to education, to training, to shopping experiences, training special forces soldiers so that can be optimized on average, but also customized for each individual, right? The great experience for you and the great experience for me are in fact different. And how do I know if I'm just sort of hitting the average? I've got to have some measurement technology. So nowadays we ask people in some kind of survey, do you like this thing? But it turns out that liking is a very poor predictor of what people actually do, because it's asking you to relate your unconscious emotional response to an experience, which is hard. By measuring brain activity via smartwatch, we can assess second by second, at a granular level, what's great about it, what's not great about it. So we see increasing applications in healthcare. So how do I actually improve people's lives? So we know that people who are happier are healthier and live longer. True for patients in hospital, true for individuals outside. So as we apply these technologies to help people live better lives, they also begin to learn about themselves. So it really, the big arc of this idea is to curate your life for greater satisfaction. So the nice thing about having developed this tool, immersion, is that now graduate students can use it at no cost. And particularly because immersion allows you to measure neurologic responses in a distributed fashion. You don't have to put people in a room anymore. We can do field experiments and measure brain activity. So we've had some amazing graduate students use this technology in their doctoral dissertations. One of the great things for me at Claremont Graduate University is how transdisciplinary it is. So my lab has people in psychology, in economics, in political science. We've had people in English. We've had individuals from philosophy. And that heterogeneity of thought and idea and approach makes us so much stronger from a research perspective. So my publications are in, I don't know, a dozen different fields because I've had this wonderful opportunity to collaborate with people across disciplines. So we all learn from each other, and we all know, or they all know, that they've got to volunteer to help each other collect data in experiments. It takes a lot of people to collect neurologic data. A lot of machines have to be running. You've got to check people in and out. You've got to check that everything is collecting data. And so by volunteering to help others, you become attached to them. You figure out what they're doing. You learn from them. And so we're really all learning from each other. You should know how you create value for an industry position. And if you want to go into academics, you should also know how you create value at a university. And having those two separate, what I call personal value statements, I think are very important when you're on the job market. So I work very closely with students to normally have both those. Some of my best students have gone to Silicon Valley. A lot of those are in data analytics. Neurologic data is the nastiest data you can work with. It's high frequency, it's got structural breaks. There's nothing on the internet as nasty as neurologic data. So if you can model data coming out of the brain, you're really set up to perform well in data analysis. So students at Facebook, at Uber, at a number of startups in Silicon Valley, at Esri down in Redlands. So they're really doing data analytics, but they're using the tools they learned to analyze these very, very large data sets coming out of the brain. And then a subset of students who will go into academics, and many of those, again, moving into data analytics or what might be called applied microeconometrics. So really kind of measuring how things are evolving at the individual level so that we have a deep understanding of how people respond to each other and to markets. So our research that we're setting up now and we'll execute late fall or early spring is on the neuroscience of flourishing. This is really something that my work has focused on for the last 20 years. But again, using distributed neuroscience technology, we can begin to study people outside the laboratory, see how their brains respond to different situations, and then begin to build up a library that tells us what really adds satisfaction to your life. And when we're satisfied in our lives, we're nicer people, we cooperate more effectively, we're better romantic partners, we're better parents, and I think we're better citizens, and so we're happier and healthier. So that seems like the most important question to me is, how do you live a happy and fulfilled life?